pleased to give this talk on space-time as a quantum circuit. Jan, it's all yours.
Right. Well, thanks for the invitation. It's too bad to have to do this online. It would have been fun to do it in person. So I scrambled something together for today. It's based on a paper that came out last week, which was written together with Ramesh Chandra, who's a PhD student, Mario Flori, who's a postdoc at Potsdam, Michal Heller, Sergio Hurtner, and Andrew Rolf. And those two guys are also postdocs in Amsterdam. Since this is being recorded, I should start with a major disclaimer, because I did a very poor job in citing other people's work. I did not have the time or energy to get all the relevant references in, so I basically have almost no references in this talk. Moreover, the number of papers that have been written on things like complexity is humongous, and it would be very difficult to do justice to all of those. So I apologize beforehand for any missing references. I should also say I've had a bit of a mixed feelings about this whole field of complexity somehow, and let me try to explain some general things about complexity before I start with the contents of the paper. So one argument that was made by Lenny Susskind with the slogan "Entanglement is not enough," and that we need more information if we do holography in order to fully capture bulk physics, is basically based on this cartoon of maybe I'll take a green pen or something. This cartoon of a black hole Penrose diagram with ADS boundary conditions, but that's not so important. And these red lines, they are spatial slices through the geometry. And as you go up in time, the length of these spatial slices turns out to grow roughly linearly in time for a very long amount of time. And that's somewhat confusing to reproduce from the boundary CFT point of view in holography. Because if you have a black hole and you perturb the black hole and you do any measurement, then typically everything thermalizes on a time scale, which is roughly the logarithm of the entropy of the black hole. It's sometimes called the scrambling time. So if you make any perturbation of a black hole and you wait for a while, then it's basically gone and invisible. It's somehow hidden in the system. So it's very hard to figure out that you did perturb the system by some simple measurement. Any simple local measurement that you make will just be like the thermal answer. But here we see a geometric feature that seems to do something interesting and non-trivial for a very, very long period of time, way past the moment where we thought the information would have been scrambled through the system. And in particular, entanglement is not able to diagnose this behavior. So the question is, what is the underlying physics? Why, what would be a right observable, if you want, in the field theory, a right quantity, a right object that is able to diagnose this important feature of the space-time geometry? The fact that these spatial slices keep on growing for a very, very large amount of time.
Sorry, Jan, wasn't there some paper maybe by Tom Hartmann a while ago where they're studying, I think it was entanglement between sort of half of the CFTs or something like that. And they did have the Ruta-Kanegi surface was looking a little bit like your red lines and they were growing with time. Am I misremembering that?
Yeah. That's right. Yeah, so you can find situations where entanglement does a little behaves a bit like this, but not literally in this particular configuration. I think that was more like a de Sitter type of setup, if I remember correctly.
I think it was the thermofield double, but evolved in a funny way.
So you can presumably cook up such cases. I don't exactly remember the detail. I think this was this paper by Hartmann and Maldacena, right?
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. but that does not address this very specific issue about like reconstructing this linear glowing length in this two-sided black hole. That is, if I remember correctly, I don't remember the details of that paper right now, but if I remember correctly, it was a different type of time evolution where you got some funny dynamics in entanglement. But it's not really capturing this particular feature that I'm that's in this cartoon picture here. But it's a good point. I should remind myself exactly what the claim was in that paper at some point. So the question was, so one way to ask a question is like, what kind of physics is going on and could possibly explain this linear growth of this length of the Einstein-Rosen bridge? Now the idea was that the notion of complexity, state complexity, might be relevant for this. Now what's complexity? So the standard definition of complexity, so there's basically two types of standard definitions of complexity that are in principle well-defined things to define. So first of all, there's the notion of state complexity, and that's defined as follows. Suppose we have some initial state psi zero, a final state psi final, and we have a certain set of unitaries, a gate set. Then you can ask, how many of those gates do you need in order, starting from the initial state, in order to get very close to the final state? So you have to include some sort of error epsilon, because typically you cannot get there exactly for any finite k. You always need to choose some little error margin epsilon. And then the smallest number of unitaries u that you need, employing this particular gate set to go from psi naught to psi final, is called the complexity of psi final with respect to the starting state psi zero. And clearly this definition of complexity depends on a couple of things. It depends on this choice of error margin epsilon. It depends on the choice of gate set. And strictly speaking, it also depends on the choice of norm that we use here. So it does depend on choices. It's not something that is a priori unambiguously well-defined. There's also another notion, a closely related notion, which is called operator complexity. There the question is not how many unitaries it takes to get a final state starting from some initial state. There the question is how many unitaries do you need to approximate a particular unitary? So starting from say the identity operator that you could imagine sitting here, you act on it with some unitaries, again from some gate set. And how many unitaries does it take to approach a final unitary with a particular error margin epsilon? These two things are very similar to each other. I won't talk much about operator complexity here. I will mostly have state complexity in mind, but as you can see, the two concepts are very similar to each other.
Sorry, highly, can yeah. I ask a question here?
It yes, please.
It seems to me that this definition depends crucially on what you choose as a set of gates or unitaries. And the question is, if it depends strongly on that, why that is useful?
I think the...
Do you have any intuition about this?
I think the I'm not a complete expert in this, but my impression is that that if you have a universal gate set, you need in order for these things to have finite answers, you need a so-called universal gate set. Otherwise, you might not even be able to get arbitrarily close to an arbitrary unitary. But there are known universal gate sets. I think there's something called the Kitaev-Solovay theorem, which proves that certain sets of unitaries are universal and that any unitary can be approximated. It might be highly, so basically what we're interested in is universal gate sets that have the property that if you make this epsilon sufficiently small and so on, that maybe the answers do not depend too much on the gate set. That is the sort of thing that we might be interested in if you want to apply this thing to field theory. In an actual, the other obvious application of all of this is in quantum computation. There, the unitaries are given to you by technology. It's whatever technology allows you to do on your qubits. And depending on whether you use a cold atom series of qubits or you use solid state qubits or whatever, different unitaries will be available. And the difficulty in preparing certain states with the gates that are technologically available might depend in a detailed way on the technology, but there the gate set is just given to you.
But the gate,
clearly there is an interesting question.
The amount of such...
what is the simplest algorithm?
So, but in that case, this number of unitaries is finite, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, thank you.
That they're typically it's finite, that's right. But it's also a finite dimensional Hilbert space. Yeah. I won't talk about this. There is another interesting notion of complexity, which is called K-complexity, which is much less dependent on choices of unitaries. It has almost no choices in it. And it's a kind of a much more, it looks like a nicer notion, ultimately to compare to holography maybe than these very discrete choices above. So these are standard sort of definitions. Now, if you want to apply all of this to a continuum theory, you might want to try to take some sort of continuum limit of this. So rather than having a discrete gate set, you might want to have a continuum gate set. And if you take some sort of continuum limit, now that has been pioneered by, this idea has been pioneered by Nielsen, then what you get is you now have continuous paths. That basically connect the initial and the final state. And it's now a continuous series of unitaries. So now in some sense, we allow ourselves to do any infinitesimal unitary. It's no longer chosen from a discrete set, but we allow ourselves to do an arbitrary infinitesimal unitary, which seems very different from having a particular discrete gate set as we had above. But now the information about the original gate set is encoded in some sort of metric on the space of infinitesimal unitaries. You could decide, for example, that doing a unitary in one direction is almost the same as doing one of your original discrete gates. So that should be easy. That does not have a large price associated to it. If you go in another direction, it's part of your original gate set. So that does not have a huge cost associated to it. But if you do something in between, it gets pricey to move in that direction because it does not align well with your original gate set. So typical continuum versions of these complexity definitions, typical continuum versions involve paths in the space of unitaries, where if you're precise for a state, the space of unitaries isn't really unitaries, but lives in some coset, because there's also unitaries that leave the state invariant, so they don't do anything. So strictly speaking, it's a path of unitaries in some coset. And if you look at the operator complexity, it is just some unitary. So now the question is, let's choose some, instead of choosing a set of gates, now we choose a metric, or a cost function on the space of unitaries. And that encodes the information about the original discrete set of gates. It could be that this gate set does not have a nice continuum or large end limit. You can't exclude it. I mean, this is all up for you to define. But if there would exist an interesting continuum limit, then this would be the best guess. Independently, you can also say this is an interesting continuum definition of complexity, where your input is some choice of metric on the space of unitaries, or very often it's referred to as a cost function, but it's really just a metric. And that also defines a notion of complexity, because you simply compute the length of the path in the relevant metric, and then the complexity is optimized if you find the shortest path. So it's basically a geodesic in this particular, the shortest geodesic in this particular metric will then be the complexity of your final state or your final unitary. Now, you might think that maybe one should always look at smooth metrics, but you could also imagine very strange metrics like that they don't have to be differentiable or anything like that. You could imagine a strange metric like this. This is also sometimes called the Manhattan metric because the distance between the origin and the point x, y is the absolute value of x plus the absolute value of y, and that's precisely the distance that it takes if you walk through Manhattan and you go from 31st Street and 5th Avenue to 38th Street and 6th Avenue. That's precisely this discrete zigzagging between the skyscrapers that corresponds to this metric. So these types of metrics are sometimes called Manhattan metrics. So you could imagine all these types of metrics. And now you can ask whether there is a natural choice of metric in a particular situation. Now we don't know. It's not clear what a nice metric would be. So suppose you now want to do this in a quantum field theory. In order to define complexity in the quantum field theory, you have to give me some choice of metric on the space of unitaries. And it's not clear whether there is a canonical choice, what that canonical choice would be, etc. However, one thing you can roughly see, I don't think I wrote that down, is that typically, so let's try to qualitatively understand where this linear growth comes from. Suppose you take a state in some complicated quantum system and you time evolve the state. Now in the beginning, if you have a system and you put a perturbation on it, in the beginning the system will thermalize. So this state evolves in some particular way through the system. And at some point the system will have thermalized and you get some typical state in the system that is very hard to distinguish from the thermodynamical limit. It's hard to distinguish from the thermal state. So initially you have a state and then it just moves somehow through it thermalizes, and then you're left with a typical state. But typical states still time evolve. If you take a typical state in a system and you time evolve it for a bit, then after a very short time, and you can estimate what that time is, after a very short time, you get a state that's orthogonal to it. These two states are indistinguishable as far as simple local measurements are concerned, because both orthogonal typical states are typical. However, from a complexity point of view, it was pretty easy to start from with your perturbation to make it to this first state, but then you get an orthogonal typical state a bit later in time, another orthogonal typical state even later in time. And although all these orthogonal typical states are indistinguishable by standard low energy probes, they are increasingly difficult to make because you have to act more and more like for a longer and longer period with the Hamiltonian in order to find all these late time typical states. So the intuition behind this picture here is that complexity grows for a very long time, is that for a very long time, you basically go through all kinds of different mutually orthogonal typical states. And only when you ran out of Hilbert space, and a typical dimension of the Hilbert space is e to the power s, where s is the entropy of the black hole, and then complexity should stop. But for a time scale of the order e to the s, complexity could well still increase because you're constantly, under time evolution, finding new orthogonal typical microstates.
Jan, yeah. Can you actually trust your bulk picture for that long of a time, like e to the s?
No, that's highly questionable. You probably cannot.
It might be questionable even for times linear in the entropy, right?
Yeah, I don't think we know very well for what time scale this can really be trusted. certainly for a timescale e to the s, by this argument, you cannot trust this picture anymore. Timescales for the s, that is something I'm not quite sure about, because that corresponds to an energy spacing that goes like 1/n. And you could argue that that's still within the regime of perturbation theory of effective field theory. So you might need to use higher order corrections. They will be important.
I think I see the S because if I take the naive fall off of correlators like e to the minus t over beta, and I take t over S, I get something that's as small as the average size of correlators.
Then you hit this noise. You mean you hit this noise regime?
Yeah. So I'm already hitting the noise, I thought, after a time. Well, but I have to be careful because actually the fall off is no longer exponential, right? After a while.
No, and well, you have to be careful with that. Also, the noise is very small. So that noise is not part of effective field theory,
right?
You could say. So effective field theory is that's not in the amplitude of the noise is exponentially suppressed. So that's not really a prediction of effective field theory. It's not supposed to be a prediction.
I was just trying to establish after what time is my bulk picture for how long can I trust this bulk picture? And if I were to compute, say, just a two-point function at separated times on a single side, I thought I might start worrying even after a time of order s.
You find disagreement. You find disagreement with the precise field theory answer, maybe. But you need to ask yourself whether you care about that exponentially small disagreement, which effective field theory is not supposed to give you anyway.
Okay.
So there's a bit of a question of what you think. We are using effective field theory, and I think effective field theory is always unreliable for any question that's exponentially suppressed anyway, for any time scale.
And actually, is this e to the s, is this also Souvrat and Kyriakos, or maybe some other people too, they had this state-dependent blah, blah, blah for the eternal black hole?
Yeah.
And they were running into some contradiction for some sufficiently long time. I think they were time evolving one side with respect to the other. Do you remember what the size of that time was? Was it e to the s or was it smaller?
I don't remember, but I seem to think it was also e to the s, yeah. That's what I think I seem to remember, yeah. So for sure, e to the s is an upper bound on the time scale for which this picture is trustworthy. But I think it depends a bit on how you define your question, whether it breaks down before that or not. Right, so this picture certainly breaks down at a time scale of the order e to the s. You can ask what happens after that. Lenny wrote a paper on that, but I'm not sure we have something very useful to say about it right now. All of this was just to motivate that a more refined probe, like complexity, which keeps track of this movement through the space of typical states after thermalization, might explain this behavior. So the idea was that complexity of the state could explain this behavior and could in some sense be dual to the length of this red line here. But in none of these statements, it was ever specified exactly which definition of complexity is supposed to be dual to this red line. If we take the continuum point of view, then you could say that any choice of metric on the space of unitaries gives you some notion of complexity. Then you can ask which choice of unitary agrees with this linear growth of this red line. And that question has never been answered. We don't know the answer to that question. So if we make a statement, complexity equals blah, 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 we really are not exactly sure what we're talking about. So in ADS-CFT, there are two conjectures for what the complexity of a state at late, well, of any state could be in terms of bulk data. So this is a bit in the spirit of the Yutaki-Yanagi formula, where you say that the entanglement entropy associated to a subregion on the boundary is given by the area of the RT surface. Except that here, again, we don't have the precise field theory description. So there's one complexity conjecture, if you want, is complexity equals volume. And I guess one can talk for a long time about all these complexity conjectures, but that's basically the statement that if you take a state at these green dots, then in order to compute the complexity of that state, you compute the volume, the minimum volume slice. You take a slice and you optimize its volume. You compute that volume. You divide that by G Newton and some ad hoc length scale, and then you get something that you call complexity of that state. And that grows at late times, that grows linearly with time, just like the length of this Einstein-Rosen bridge does. Another proposal is that complexity of this state, that's the complexity equals action proposal, is given by the on-shell effective action of this Wheeler de Witt patch, which is the entire interior of this causal diamond. And both these proposals satisfy reasonable criteria. But again, we don't know what they're dual to precisely. We might believe that they're dual to a suitable definition of complexity in the field theory, but we don't know the corresponding gate set of, or if you like the continuum language, you don't know what Nielsen's geometry, what geometry on the space of unitaries is dual to these bulk quantities that we do not know.
So Jan, I'm very confused about the second proposal, because I don't understand how it's well defined. That is, I mean, I can maybe compute this volume of the Wheeler de Witt patch, because this patch is seeming to get very close to the singularity, right?
That's right.
So normally I would think that maybe I can compute this in Einstein gravity, but close to the singularity, I would expect higher curvature corrections to become important. And then I would think that this would actually lead to divergent contributions to this
you're absolutely right. So I don't.
It seems like a very ill-defined quantity, actually.
What it seems to be. But if you ignore higher derivative corrections and you just stick in, you just compute Einstein gravity, then the blow up of the curvature is weaker, is canceled by the square root of g.
I understand. But how can I ignore them? I'm close to a singularity.
No, you cannot, and you should not. You could also imagine that maybe you should introduce a little cutoff here and stop there and use that as your measure. But I don't think this question has been answered. The observation is that if you ignore higher derivative corrections and you just do this computation Einstein gravity, you get a number. And that number seems to have some properties that agree with the types of properties that generic notions of complexity are believed to have. I think that's all you can say about it at this point.
But how seriously am I supposed to take this?
That's up to you. The talk, right? you can take it. I mean, this is a computation you can do in Einstein gravity in the bulk. You could also just define this to be a number you can associate to this bulk geometry. That number, if you compute it with this particular algorithm, spits out a number, and that number.
I agree, this number is ill-defined.
We could introduce a little regulator close to the singularity, like we typically do near the UV boundary of AdS-CFT. Introduce a little cutoff.
I have an infinite number of higher derivative corrections.
If we choose the cutoff sufficiently far from the singularity so that higher derivative corrections can still be ignored, then so that the curvature is sufficiently small still, then you get some answer. It will depend on this cutoff, but maybe the dependence and the cutoff is kind of mild and etc. Or maybe you can even
So this dependence on the cutoff would be smaller, much smaller than somehow the volume of the Wheeler-DeWitt patch, which is why
I don't know all the ins and outs of this proposal, but I would imagine that this is something, these are words one could say.
Sorry, but Jan, if you're putting in a cutoff and then starting to try and regulate this, why isn't that just the same as actually having to renormalize gravity? Because that's exactly what you seem to be arguing you have to do in order to make this thing make sense.
Yeah, you probably would, I don't know. If we believe gravity is a low energy effective field theory, which is reasonably okay up to points in space-time where the curvature becomes too large, we could try to associate a number to it in this way. I share your skepticism about some of these things, because this is just a recipe to extract a number from a bulk geometry. You could call it, it's the on-shell effect function. We can also give it a different name. We just say, well, all that you need to do is you need to compute the volume of this diamond. That's all that you need to do. Maybe that gives a similar type of number. So there is some way to associate a number to this. You also have to carefully discuss the null boundaries, which is non-trivial, and extra boundary terms that you have. And there is some ambiguity, some normalization ambiguity. So there's many technicalities that are complicated if you want to compute this action in this way.
Jan, I think it's clear that at least if you don't have higher derivative corrections, the on-shell action is finite. So it's whether of course, higher derivative action is finite or not depends on knowing it exactly. So that's a different story.
No, that we don't know. So from a strict, like, if you want to really, really interpret this as the on-shell effective action, then obviously it's an ill-defined question, because we have this singularity that is not part of effective field theory.
For this talk, can we focus on the complexity equals volume conjecture, or do we need to address this other one?
No. I just wanted to say a few words of background. So this is not what this talk is about. You can also take volume, which is better defined, and so on. But you can come up with any recipe to spit out numbers associated to states defined at different times and call that complexity. And then one challenge could be to figure out whether any of these definitions have any connection to some notion of geometry on the space of unitaries. So instead of saying, if your conjecture is that complexity equals volume, it's not exactly clear what your conjecture is. I guess the conjecture is that there exists a not completely unreasonable metric on the space of unitaries in the field theory, such that if you were able to compute complexity with that metric, you would get something that agrees with the volume of this slice. That seems to be like the equals volume conjecture. But it's a much less precise conjecture than Ryutaki-Inagi, obviously, because there we actually have a microscopic understanding of both sides of the statement. And here, it's almost more like a spiritual statement. Good. Also, we don't really specify the initial state when we make these statements. What people typically have in mind is that the initial state is something completely unentangled. In other words, it has no space-time interpretation whatsoever. But that's somehow not very important for many of these studies. You can be somewhat agnostic about what your initial state is. Now, you could say, well, this is even by the standards of string theory, this is pretty flaky, because we relate things to things that are not very well defined and all that. On the other hand, if you think about any notion of complexity that you could apply in the continuum limit, it will probably need to satisfy some consistency conditions. And you can check that both these proposals here, complexity equals volume and complexity equals action, defined in this way, that they do obey some basic properties that you think any reasonable notion of complexity should have. One important check is something called, I won't explain it, it's something called a switchback effect, which you can diagnose by shooting shockwaves into the background. And both of these things have this switchback effect in them. And it's not so easy to find other bulk quantities that also have this switchback effect properly taken into account. So that is sometimes used to advertise why, although flaky, maybe not completely crazy, candidates for some notion of complexity. Now, what you can do on the field theory side in order to study a little bit what's going on, you can, for example, try to take free field theory. There's many papers on that where you try to explore the space of unitaries, a typical set of unitaries that people have explored, but that's very, very restrictive. In free field theory is to look at unitaries that sort of create, that rotate creation and annihilation operators into each other. And if you use that as your basic unitaries, you can get do computations in free field theory that share some features with complexity equals volume and so on. You could also believe that if you have a system with symmetries like a conformal symmetry or Virasoro, that perhaps the measure, the natural metric on the space of unitaries should be compatible with the symmetries of the system. That seems very reasonable from a continuum field theory point of view. It's not necessarily very reasonable from a gate point of view, because why would acting with symmetry generators from a circuit point of view be so much easier or more natural than acting with maybe a non-symmetry generator? But you do get reasonable answers if you restrict yourself, say, to conformal group generators and you compute certain quantities and so on. Right. Now, talking a bit more, I need to explain one more little thing before going to sort of the actual content of this paper. But I was asked to be very general in the first half hour, which I have been trying to do so far. So in a two-dimensional conformal field theory, this is just an example. There's an interesting set of preparations of the ground state. Namely, in a two-dimensional conformal field theory, you can take a hemisphere, you can put some metric on the hemisphere. This metric needs to have some boundary condition at the equator, but that's just a technicality. And then you can do a path integral in Euclidean two-dimensional conformal field theory of the hemisphere, and then it produces for you the ground state wave function on the circle, on the boundary of the Euclidean manifold. As always, if you have a Euclidean manifold with a boundary, and you do the path integral over the Euclidean manifold, you get a wave function associated to the boundary. That's also true here, and in this case, it's the ground state.
Sorry, why is it the ground state? It's a state which depends on the choice of your metric, right? On a disk.
That's right. However, you can always go to conformal gauge. And then because of conformal invariance, well, basically there's a conformal map that maps the hemisphere to the semi-infinite cylinder.
Okay.
And then it's obvious that you have the ground state. So it's conformal invariance plus that. You can discretize this. You could try to discretize this metric. So a fantastic cartoon is drawn here, which is now some sort of tensor network, a discretization of this path integral. And you could interpret this tensor network as some circuit of operations that you do. And in particular, you could interpret this discretized tensor network as something that builds the ground state out of nothing. Because you start, say, here with basically nothing, and then you add a few pieces of Hilbert space, and then you add some more tensors and some more Hilbert space, etc. So it's almost like you build up the state from nothing. And the details of this tensor network will depend on the details of the metric, because it's supposed to be representative of some sort of discretization of this metric. So a question you can ask is, in continuum field theory, is there a reasonable notion of cost associated to this particular method of preparation? The whole spirit of complexity is that if you make states in certain ways, there's a cost associated to that process. The process with the least amount of effort, with the smallest cost, that is sort of the complexity of this. But for any preparation, for any trajectory to go there, there's a notion of cost. It's just the length of the path in the space of unitaries, if you want. And you can ask, what's a reasonable cost to associate to this method of preparation? So a proposal of Tadashi and friends is called path integral optimization. It's a proposal where the idea is that the complexity associated, or the effort or the cost that's associated to this particular preparation of the state, is proportional to the logarithm of the unnormalized path integral that you do over the hemisphere, which then turns out to be the Liouville field action. If you go to conformal gauge, if you don't go to conformal gauge, it's like the Polyakov action, because that's just the effective action for a 2D CFT with some coupled to a background metric.
Jan, this definition does not seem to depend on any initial state.
No, this does not depend on initial state. This is just preparing it in this way. And in some sense, we're preparing it out of nothing here. It's like a no boundary proposal. So we're sort of preparing it from nothing. So we're not acting with unitaries in a fixed Hilbert space. At least that's not what it looks like. So it's some preparation. It's not quite on the nose. I will say something in a minute. It's not quite on the nose the same as moving through some fixed Hilbert space with unitaries, it seems. So this is a slightly different process. But you can interpret it as moving through a fixed Hilbert space. But I'll say that in a minute.
Another quick comment about renormalizability again. In two dimensions, I don't have an issue with this, but if you try and do this in higher dimensions, any kind of statement that the result is independent of the discretization has to be some statement about universality of a renormalization scheme, because the discretization is just a regularization in some sense of the process. And to say the result is independent of the regularization, or there's a universal extractable result, boils down, I think, to renormalizability, the underlying gravity. Two dimensions, okay, you've got Liouville theory and you've got things under control. But in anything other than two dimensions, you're dead in the water.
That's right. So you should not take this too literal, by the way. This is just for inspirational purposes, this picture.
Sorry, can I say something on this? If the underlying gravity theory you get is a string theory, you don't expect a problem with that. Although technically how to do it, of course, it would be difficult, right?
I would agree with that. It's just that everybody in this does this, just messes around with four-dimensional Euclidean quantum gravity and forget it.
Sure, this issue of the continuum limit of this tensor network, that's an important question. I don't even think that you really can take a proper continuum limit of this picture in a way that makes sense. This is just a cartoon that is supposed to give you some feeling for how you could try to think about this particular preparation of the state if you insisted on thinking of it in terms of gates. But ultimately, we want to think about everything and always in the continuum limit and never go back to this discretized picture. Now, if you believe this statement, that is unnormalized path integral of the field theory coupled to a fixed background is the complexity of this thing, then you get something like the Liouville action in conformal gauge, and you can ask when this is optimized. And then it turns out that the optimal geometry, the thing with the smallest complexity, defined in this somewhat ad hoc fashion, if you want, it turns out to be Euclidean AES2. So although we did a purely field theory computation, this is just a computation in a 2D field theory coupled to a background metric, the optimal geometry that comes out happens to look like the geometry of an equal time slice in AdS3. However, we were not doing anything in the bulk of ADS. We were doing a 2D CFT computation. It's also interesting that this Euclidean AdS2 also is precisely the geometry of that resembles MERA, this, as Brian Swingle pointed out. So that's kind of nice because MERA is also believed to be the simplest preparation of ground states in a variety of models in 2D CFT. So the fact that we get a geometry out whose discretization happens to be a tensor network that happens to be the simplest preparation of a ground state in a 2D CFT, that's all very suggestive that this is on the right track.
So here you put these vacuum boundary conditions. Can this be generalized to more complicated boundary conditions for your path integral?
You could, but then you should include sources on the hemisphere.
Has this been done, or is it just been done for the vacuum?
Only for primaries at the South Pole, I think, so that you get in. Basically, you get AdS2 with a conical defect at the origin, so that has been done. I don't think more general states have been considered.
I see. Thanks.
Now, I should emphasize that although MERA looks like you're preparing a ground state from nothing, there are these dots here where basically one line come in and two lines go out, like this one here or this one here. You can always make this into a unitary circuit by adding another fiducial line here that always sits in a fixed state. So you can interpret MERA in two ways. You can say either it creates the ground state out of nothing, but you could also say it creates the ground state out of the tensor product of some completely unentangled state to begin with. Mathematically, these two statements are pretty much equivalent. And this could be this completely unentangled state that is the hypothetical ground state with respect to which all these notions of complexity are defined.
Yeah, may I ask a question?
Yeah.
If I take a generic tensor network, I would expect that it doesn't correspond just to a metric, but also some sources for other operators, right, in the CFT.
That's right.
So how do you distinguish those networks that they just discretize a particular metric on the that you can prepare just by integrating over the metrics?
Yeah, in general, these tensors, they this is only the discretization of the geometry if all these tensors are identical to each other. And you, for example, identify the distance in space with the distance with like the, and if you associate unit length to each link in this tensor network, and you imagine all the tensors are roughly the same, then this is the discretization of some geometry. But in practice, there can be lots of fine structure in all these tensors. And all the information about other operators and matter fields and everything would then be encoded in the detailed properties of these tensors that would no longer have to be the same at different points. So you could put a lot more information in these types of networks if you wanted to. But at this point, it's just a cartoon. It's all just suggestive. But I don't want to go too much into this discretized point of view anyway. This was just to motivate. That is a bit striking that if you take this continuum ansatz, namely, let's just say that the path integral, the unnormalized path integral measures the complexity, then we get an answer. It doesn't seem entirely unreasonable. You get a suggestive connection to this MERA network. You do get something that looks like an equal time slice of AdS3, which is also the minimum volume slice in AdS3, etc. Yes, thanks, Boris. Okay.
Jan, can I ask you a question?
Yep.
So do you have any intuition why the why the geometry, when it is optimized, you get ADS2 rather than, for example, DS2? Like,
well, here everything was Euclidean to begin with. So there is no opportunity here to get something non-Euclidean. We are optimizing in some space of Euclidean metrics on a Euclidean hemisphere. So I don't see how you could have gotten anything else in this particular case.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Good, so now there's a puzzle, but this was one of the reasons to think more about. So one of the puzzles was that if you take this path integral optimization point of view, you start with a purely 2D CFT computation, which is at the boundary of, which is always taking place at the boundary of ADS3. But somehow the final result seemed to be the geometry on a spatial slice of ADS3. So it's very mysterious somehow how this boundary got rotated inward, because this CFT computation is always done at the boundary. But maybe it was done with some finite small cutoff at the boundary, but then once the cutoff becomes large, you can no longer trust the boundary computation. So what's going on? How did actually this boundary 2D CFT get rotated inward? This was one of the confusing observations here. Maybe this ADS3 picture was misleading, but anyway. So looking at all this stuff, we came up with a different proposal for how to do these types of computations, which is as follows. So suppose we take, for simplicity again, ADS3. I'm suppressing the space coordinate. So I'm just showing you a slice with a time coordinate, Euclidean time coordinate T and a radial coordinate Z. And suppose we take some bulk region M, which is bounded. So it follows some sort of trajectory Z equals rho of T. On this boundary, there will be an induced metric. And you could imagine that the 2D CFT lives on this induced metric, but we have gone all the way, we have gone a finite distance from the boundary inward. So it's certainly not the ordinary CFT that lives on that induced metric. It is some sort of CFT with a cutoff, because this radial distance in ADS CFT, it also corresponds to a notion of a UV cutoff. So we have, apparently this boundary describes some sort of CFT, but with a cutoff. And that cutoff depends on time in this case. So it has a time, Euclidean time dependent cutoff in it. So it's a more general type of thing. It's not just a CFT in a weird metric. It's a CFT with a weird metric and with a cutoff, which also depends on space and in general time. Now we can interpret this gray region again by the general philosophy of Euclidean path integrals with boundaries. We can interpret the gray region as some sort of thing, some sort of procedure that takes this particular ground state with this particular cutoff and maps it to the same ground state at a later Euclidean time, but with this particular cutoff. And the precise details of this curve rho of t describe some procedure to map one ground state with one cutoff to the ground state with a different cutoff at later times. And you can ask, well, this is a particular procedure. It's a particular operation that you can do. It takes a certain amount of Euclidean time. So this is a particular circuit of some sort or another, which maps the ground state at one cutoff. And then you do something to it and you get the ground state for a different value of the cutoff. What's the cost of this particular circuit? And the proposal is very simple. In order to compute the cost of this particular circuit, you simply compute the on-shell action of the gray region M. And that is then basically the complexity of the path that is described by a choice rho of T. and different choices, rho of t, are different trajectories. They're different ways. You can first go up in time and then change the cutoff, or you can first change the cutoff and then go up in Euclidean time. So there's different ways to connect these two states to each other. And all of these describe some path in the space of states, and the cost associated to it in the spirit of this Nielsen geometry is the proposal is given by the on-shell action of M.
Sorry, Jan. So if I take Z final to be the same as Z initial, then I have a non-zero answer for the complexity.
Then you, sorry, have a?
Non-zero answer for the complexity, because it seems that the action of
Yeah, you do that because you could just go straight up. You go straight up, but then you do a certain series of Euclidean time evolutions. These time evolutions do not have any impact on the state. So you have a state and you say you apply some gates to it. They're really dumb because they don't do anything to the state, but you still wasted effort applying the gates to them. That's the idea.
Applying a what? Sorry, I didn't understand.
Applying some gates to the, like, let's. Gates. Some gates, yeah. You just used to, you chose some unitaries. You applied those unitaries to the state. They happen to not do anything to the state, but you still wasted effort applying those unitaries. That's the idea. Why you still get a non-trivial answer even if you don't change the cutoff.
So I shouldn't think, because I thought maybe I should think of it as you seem to be saying before, that I get some effort by just doing the time evolution itself.
That's right. Even in an energy eigenstate, yeah, just applying the Hamiltonian takes some effort, even if it doesn't do anything.
Okay, thanks.
That's the idea. Yeah. So now, in vacuum ages 3, you can actually compute this on-shell effective action M. There's one little fun subtlety here. So this is the planar ages 3 metric. There's one little fun subtlety here, which has to do with the fact that there's some corners here, and you need to include corner contributions to your action for self-consistency. I won't go into too much detail of what these corner terms are. And then if you work out what the effective action is, you get this answer in terms of rho. So it has like something that looks like a potential term and something that looks like a kinetic term. And then this you can basically ignore for everything for now. So this is some answer that describes the effort associated to this procedure. And then you can ask what the optimal solution is. What is the thing that minimizes complexity? What is the trajectory that does it? And if you solve the field equations of this action, you find that if you keep this time separation fixed, that the best solution you can have is if this boundary, this curve rho of t, is part of a circle, of a semicircle attached to the boundary. It's basically a geodesic, it turns out, in this particular geometry. So that is the, strangely enough, this is the configuration that makes it as efficient as possible for a given time separation. But then you can also ask, for which can I now make the action even smaller by changing the time separation? And it turns out that if you optimize over initial and final time, then you squeeze this domain together until it all lies in an equal time slice. But in that limit, you still have a non-trivial effective action, which ultimately, if you want, has to do with these corner terms. And that effective action happens to be precisely the volume. I drew an annulus here, but in this case, it would be strips. And you get the final answer, and it is just proportional to the differences between these UV cutoffs. And in particular, if you send Zi to infinity, which would be the case where you have a trivial initial state with zero UV cutoff, then this is just the same as the area of the equal time slice. So this reproduces complexity equals volume in the sense that the cost function we have defined here, if we optimize it, it spits out the volume of this slice. So in this example, it agrees with complexity equals volume.
So Jan, what boundary condition did you put on this cutoff surface, the varying cutoff surface?
I compute the on-shell effective action with the, so, and I use the standard Gibbons-Hawking boundary term, which is basically telling me that I'm using Dirichlet boundary conditions.
So you choose the boundary condition such that ADS3 is a solution, basically.
Well, it's also it's all leading order, but if you want to interpret this as a path in scope of boundary conditions, then the it's Dirichlet on this boundary, not at infinity, but on this boundary. So Dirichlet boundary conditions here, if they translate into mixed boundary conditions here. But in order to do this finite domain computation, yeah, you have in mind having Dirichlet boundary conditions on this finite domain.
Okay.
We can ask much more generally, if we do this in a general setting, what the optimal result is. So for that, we have to think a little bit. So suppose we have some region M, and it could be in any state. And we but this is just a purely gravitational situation. And suppose we have some boundary, and suppose we just move it in a given fixed background. So I don't want to also change the metric that we have, because I want to keep both the initial and the final state fixed, and that fixes the background geometry I'm in. If I wanted, if I were, you could also vary the metric, but then you're varying either the initial or the final state. And I wanted to do a problem where I keep the initial and final state fixed. So the only variation is the variation of the boundary, but in a fixed bullet geometry. Now you can figure out that if you have a finite boundary here and another finite boundary here, and epsilon of r is the orthogonal displacement factor in a direction orthogonal to the slice, then the change in the action under certain orthogonal displacement factor is given by this expression here that just follows from some GR stuff, where pi is the effective action varied with respect to the boundary metric. We're not going to actually do this variation because we want to move in a fixed background, but if you were to do this variation, you would get a pi menu. You could call that the this is basically the Brown-York stress tensor. It's the stress tensor on this finite boundary. If you imagine that there is a field theory on this finite boundary and you want to know what its stress tensor is, you just vary the effective action with respect to that stress tensor and you spit out with respect to the metric on this boundary. And if you vary the action with respect to the metric on that boundary, you get what you could call the stress tensor of that cut off CFT, whatever lives on that boundary. And this thing in the green box, this is precisely the TT bar deformation, in the sense that if you were to rewrite this in complex coordinates in two dimensions, it would look exactly like TT bar. But these are the T and the T bar on this finite cut off surface, not in the UV theory. But you can see in this way that flowing along this family of purple lines is like some sort of TT bar flow, where for each infinitesimal step, you need to take the T and the T bar as defined on this purple surface. But it has a coefficient that depends on space and time in general. Whereas in many standard TT bar discussions, one always has straight lines, in which case this epsilon is just a constant and it's more like a proper TT bar deformation. So you can derive a general flow equation of flowing this boundary in this general background. And then you can, this is everything here I already said, except I should emphasize, I'm just using the bulk effective action without counter terms. So as I go to the boundary, this thing would diverge. You could also include counter terms if you wanted to, but if you just look at finite bulk variations, it's not clear why you would want to care about counter terms. So we don't include, we have a separate discussion on what happens if you include counter terms, but here I'm not. And now it's easy to figure out for what types of surfaces this is optimized, because you just figure out when the variation of the action vanishes. Then you get some scalar equation, which you can rewrite using the Hamiltonian constraint as an equation for the scalar curvature on the slice on the boundary. And it turns out that it's optimized whenever the scalar curvature is has a particular negative value. So it's always a constant scalar curvature boundary. So in a purely, you could try to include matter and redo it with matter, but if you're in a purely gravitational situation, this suggests that there is a preferred role for slices with constant scalar curvature. So maybe we should have another complexity conjecture, the CR conjecture, where complexity equals curvature, in the sense that the complexity has something to do with constant scalar curvature slices in the bulk. Now, I have only a few minutes left, and because I have a fairly hard cutoff in 7 minutes. Now you can ask whether, okay, these are all nice words, and yeah, that's great, John, you did yet another ADS3 computation. And now you can ask whether there's like a gate counting interpretation of this this answer. I think this is in principle an interesting suggestion to explore the meaning of these constant curvature slices. You can ask if there's a gate counting interpretation of some sort, a continuum version of gate counting. That's not entirely straightforward or clear. You could write this trajectory that you move through the bulk as a sequence of steps where you combine little Euclidean time evolutions with little TT bar deformations, if you want, that change the cutoff of the theory. And from that point of view, you could almost write this entire procedure in a formal sense as some sort of Wilson line-ish expression, where at each step in time, you do a little bit of time evolution going up and you do a little TT bar deformation going sideways. And you could try to associate a natural cost function to this process written in this way. You could try to examine commutation relations between H and TT bar and see if they all depend on this rho of T, so it's kind of complicated. But you could try to explore the algebra of these operators and see if there's a natural metric on the corresponding space of operators and use that metric to try to associate a cost to this. And it would be quite interesting to see if that can be done. So that's a great open question. Is there a natural geometry on these spaces of operators? And if so, what does it bias? But superficially, you can see how that h of rho t is presumably related to 1 over rho squared in the action, because h of rho is just time evolution. It's in some CFT with a cutoff. And if you discretize the theory, it has a lattice spacing 1 over rho. So the number of tensors that you need, the tensor density that you would very naively write down, if you were going to discretize the theory, the tensor density would be 1 over rho squared. So this first term here looks like you're just counting a standard tensor density. So it's easy to make an argument for this particular connection. To see exactly why this is connected to that is less clear. It could either go through examining the algebra of the operators. It's also possible because you can rewrite this term in terms of this angle in this very simple way, that maybe maybe rotating tensors is somehow involved because it's proportional to this rotation angle. But it seems difficult to find a very precise interpretation of that type right now. But that's an interesting idea for future work. Let me briefly mention that you can actually interpret this thing as some notion of distance using what's known as kinematic space. So if you take this trajectory and you draw these large circles that were also the optimal solutions, you can encode all the information about this bell curve rho of t. You can encode it in the information in these pairs of points t1 of t and t2 of t. And that's just an interesting natural geometric encoding of the shape of rho of t in terms of boundary data. And once you encode it in terms of boundary data, this curve rho of t lives in the bulk. So it's a complicated thing. It doesn't transform in a nice way under conformal symmetry. So we cannot really use conformal symmetry. But if you map it to the boundary in some canonical geometrical way, on the boundary, we do have conformal symmetry. And in fact, there is this nice metric, the so-called kinematic space metric, which follows purely from SL2 invariants, which associates a notion of distance to pairs of times like this. And then it turns out that this entire effective action with a few technicalities, is simply given by the distance covered in this particular geometry, but weighted with an extra rho, which you can explain again in terms of tensor densities. So now it looks much more like a Nielsen type thing where you actually compute a distance in some auxiliary metric. So this strongly suggests that this kinematic space geometry is perhaps the relevant Nielsen geometry that we were looking for to explain this answer. And that was basically it. So there's a few remarks I can super fast go through. You can do the same computation in global ADS with a trivial initial state, and you would look at surfaces like this. You can optimize over that. It's the same story. You get, again, complexity equals volume out in empty ADS. I used a state. It was very natural to choose a constant time slice to define my state. But in a general background, there's no canonical time slice to choose. So most likely for these types of computations, the most natural slices to choose in the bulk are the ones that have a vanishing extrinsic curvature. But maybe other choices can be done as well. Everything I did was in a given on-shell solution of the bulk field equations. In principle, there should be off-shell circuits. In Nielsen geometry, you can just use arbitrary unitaries to do anything. But if you were to use an off-shell bulk solution and you would still apply this recipe, then it would be exponentially suppressed. So perhaps the complexity, the Nielsen geometry that underlies ADS-CFT is one where moving under time evolution in a given semi-classical bulk geometry is relatively cheap, but actually moving away from that and changing the bulk geometry is expensive. But that I'm not sure about. Then you can see that if you try to do something in Lorentzian signature, you can try to repeat these arguments. It appears that depending on what you optimize precisely, you could either again end up with complexity equals volume, or if you start with these time-like slices, you might end up with complexity equals action, but there are clearly things to be understood here. You can check that in the BTZ black hole, these constant curvature slices also seem to exhibit linear lay-time growth, which was an important hallmark of complexity. And the relation with this kinematic space suggests that perhaps there is an interesting connection between this notion of complexity and the notion of entanglement wedge reconstruction. And then maybe what we're really measuring here can be reinterpreted as some sort of cost associated to reassembling a state given entanglement wedges. And I'll stop there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Jan. So I should ask how much time you have for questions because you have other commitments.
Maybe one urgent question because I'm happy to answer anything over email, but otherwise I'll be very late for my other meeting, which is kind of an urgent one as well.
Okay.
May I ask a question? Hello?
Yeah, hi.
Jan, the following question. The tensor network, does it, which you explained in the middle of the talk, does it start reminding a little bit the old red discretized gravity in two dimensions, then its quantum version would be sum over these networks. Isn't it like Minkowskian version of that old Euclidean regular gravity?
Yeah, I haven't thought about that. That's an interesting question.
Especially that you end up with Liouville metric, of course.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And another question, it's related question. The complexity you compute, does it have something to do with the Hausdorff dimension of this two-dimensional manifold which you consider?
Not in a way that's immediately obvious to me. However, that's an interesting question as well. Because we are somehow, if you have one of these tensor configurations and you count the number of tensors as a function of the distance, and there would be an interesting power law, which would be the Hausdorff dimension that you would associate to it. Maybe that has a nice meaning in this context. Yeah, so I need to think about it. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, so let's thank all Jan for the very inspiring talk.
Thank you, Jan.
Okay, guys, it was a lot of fun. Yeah, I'm sorry, I really need to run, but again, if you have a question, by all means, send me an email because I'd love to chat a bit more about this.